So I want to introduce our team. So I'm Lisa Blecker. I'm here just for technical support and to host the webinar. I'm the Pesticide Safety Education Program Coordinator with the UC Statewide IPM Program. And our presenter today is Maria Alfaro. She is an educator in the program. We do statewide pesticide safety outreach. Also providing technical support are Sarah Hernick, another educator in the program, and also Katrina Hunter, who is a writer in the program. So I'm going to pass the mic to Maria. The title of today's presentation is Label Reading for Safe Applications, and Maria's going to tell you all about it. Please remember to put your questions in the Q&A and respond to the polls as they come up. I will try not to close them too quickly. And I'm going to hand it over to Maria.
Hello, everyone. Welcome. And I hope you guys are all in the right place. We're going to be talking about labels, pesticide labels, and how to read them so that we ensure safe applications when we are using pesticides. So let's jump right in. We're going to talk about what is a pesticide label, and also the important information you can expect to find on labels and where in a label you can find them. We're also going to be addressing the differences between a pesticide label and an SDS, the safety data sheet, where you are required to keep the labels on your work site, and we'll get to that as well. And what are some of the ways in which we are different in California? And that is going to be peppered throughout the entire presentation, because if you probably already know, we're really special in California, and so we are different from the other states and the federal law in different ways. And finally, resources for you. Those we will also be giving you information and links and resources throughout the presentation, so be on the lookout for those in the chat box. All right, so what is a pesticide label? It is a complex legal document, and it is something that it's the booklet that the EPA requires manufacturers to have attached to the containers, and it contains detailed safety instructions on how to protect yourself when you're making applications, and it also includes very detailed use instructions. And I want to make the point that it is an approved legal document at the federal level. It is a federal document, it's a legal document, and so any uses that are in conflict with what's on that label means you have broken the federal law, okay? So, like I was mentioning, the label, usually you see them attached to the containers, and if the container is too small, it might have a little booklet. And keep in mind that if the booklet becomes detached from it, you can actually go to manufacturer websites like Agrion or CDMS and look up the information. The writing on the booklets can be really small, so you can, if you go to CDMS or Agrion, you can print out information and actually it'll be easier to read. So anything attached to the container, and if it has a little booklet, that together is the full pesticide label, okay? So when should you be reading a label? Well, it's really important to read the label before you buy a product, before you mix a product, before you load, before you're gonna apply, before storing, before you transport the product, and also while you're transporting it. So why is it important to read a label before you buy the product? Well, if you purchase a product and you get back to your field and you're about ready to use it, and you find out that the site which you want to apply the product on is actually not on the label. You cannot use that product. What if, you know, it can't be used under the current weather conditions? Are there different restrictions at your application site? Does it actually target the life stage of your pest? And furthermore, read the label for personal protective equipment requirements. What will you need? So it's really important to read it before you buy the product. So before you mix it and apply the pesticide, it's important to know what are the first aid and medical treatments if there is an exposure, right? You want to be prepared for that. And also know how to mix it and safely apply the material. You also want to take precautions to prevent exposure for to other people and non-target organisms. When you are storing the product, make sure you keep it in the original containers. It's locked and in areas away from children, and you're taking precautions to prevent fire and explosion hazards. So those are all the reasons why you want to read the label. We think this is a very important statement, so we're going to reiterate it throughout the presentation. It is a violation of federal law to use the product in a manner that is inconsistent with its labeling. Okay, so what does it mean that it's a federal legal document? Well, the EPA administers a worker protection standard, and it is designed to protect field workers and pesticide handlers from exposure to pesticides. And so let me start this. So we have one layer of the regulations, which is what I just mentioned. The EPA administers that, and so they are the ones that are, what is the word I'm looking for? They're the ones that approve the labels and registration for pesticide registration. Okay. And then at the state level, so we have California, the Department of Pesticide Regulation, whom we know as DPR, and they actually have the right to add layers of protection and regulation. And because the label is a federal document, it will not have the state requirements. So you need to know what those are, okay? And on top of that, we also have the county regulations, and they are, it's the ag commissioners, and they can add local regulations. So if you're working in multiple counties, it's important to know if each county has additional regulations. And what do we have here? We have what we like to call cake, because we are special in California and we like a lot of cake. So I've talked a lot about being in conflict with the label, so we're going to launch poll number one. Okay, so the question is, which of the following is considered to be a use in conflict with a pesticide label? So using the pesticide on a crop or site, that is not a complete sentence. That is not on the label. Using the pesticide to target a pest that is not on the label. Using an application rate that is lower than what is cited on the label, that's what it should read. And using the pesticide on a crop or site that's not listed on the label. I apologize for the typo on this one. Okay, it looks like most of you have answered. And if you responded to using the pesticide on a crop or site that is not listed on the label, you are correct. So believe it or not, in California, we can actually, we can use a pesticide on a target that is not on the label within certain parameters. So for example, we have new pests, new insects, and for like fuller rose beetle. These are newer ones and they're important to us, but they may not be listed on the label. Well, if you have an insecticide that can be effective against fuller rose beetle and you follow all the other instructions and regulations and restrictions, then you can use it if it is registered on the crop, okay? And you follow the instructions and actually use it, you can use it on that pest, okay? But you cannot use an insecticide or an herbicide to try to combat an insect, okay? That is not what we mean by using it in conflict with the label. Okay, so we have an additional, we're launching poll number two. Which of the following must be on the front panel or front page of the pesticide label? Mode of action, directions for use, or active ingredient? Okay, it looks like most of you have responded. Great, very good. The active ingredient is on the front page of the pesticide label. So what information do we usually find on pesticide labels, and what information is required to be on a pesticide label? So we're going to go through different sections of the label, and the restricted use pesticide statement. If you see here, this box right here, and we have, this is a restricted use pesticide statement. So pesticides are either classified as general use or restricted use. Pesticides without the statement are general use pesticides, and when there are special restrictions, you will see this box. That is required to be on the front page. So if we have this other pesticide that has that box, and you will see that this actually also contains information about the reason why you can only use it in certain situations, and it's restricted. So it says right here that it's for ground application only because there are ground and surface water concerns. So what does it mean when a pesticide is classified as restricted use? It means that you need to be a certified applicator, and you need to have a license in order to buy it, to use it, or supervise its use. Okay, and these are federal restrictions. Remember, this is a federal document, it's a federal restriction, and yes, there may also be some state restrictions. So some products labels may not have the restricted use pesticide statement on it. Check with your ag commissioner to see if it may be restricted at the state level. And these are things that you just need to know, okay? Let's see, we have the next section of the label is the brand name. The brand name also is required to be on the front page of the label, and that is because it is it's proprietary information or brand to the manufacturer. And if, for example, you know, we have Daconil Action, but Daconil and Syngenta produce different products, and each brand may contain different active ingredients associated with that. I also want to say that we're going to be using different labels and excerpts from different labels, and we're not sponsored by any of these manufacturers. We're not pushing any product, nor are we picking on any product, okay? So like Lisa says, we like the labels, the colors are nice, and so we're going to use those, okay? The ingredients of the product are also listed on the front page. So you will see that it contains the active ingredient, and the chemical name, and sometimes it will also have other ingredients. And by other ingredients, it doesn't mean that those are not dangerous ingredients. Those are actually ingredients that work in conjunction with the active ingredient to make it more effective. And but it is the active ingredient which actually kills the pest that you are targeting. And it'll give you the information very clearly as to the percentage of the active ingredient. Yeah, that's all I want to say about that. We also have on the front page, keep out of reach of children and the signal word. And these, again, are required to be on the pesticide label. Sometimes that information is required to be on the front page. Sometimes you will find it on another page. They will always be very near each other. Okay, so we'll see in this example that it says very clearly, keep out of reach of children. This one is, the signal word is danger poison. And because it's danger poison, it has to be written in English and Spanish. And we need the skull and crossbones to be present as well. Okay. Now that we've talked a little bit about signal words, we can launch poll number 3. Which of the following signal words indicates the least amount of hazard? We have warning, caution, or danger. Fantastic. Caution is the word that indicates the least amount of hazard. So, all right. So before we go into more discussion about signal words, let's look at the signal word caution. And we'll launch poll number 4. All right. What does the signal word caution indicate about a pesticide's toxicity? It is not toxic to humans. It has a low acute human toxicity. Or it has a low chronic human toxicity. Okay, fantastic. So the answer is it has a low acute human toxicity. So what does that mean? Okay, well, let's look at this. It definitely does not mean that it's not toxic to humans, because why else would we have a label telling us how to keep safe, which PPE to use, and why would the product need to be registered and with DPR? Okay, so that's not what it means. And so now we're looking at, it has a low chronic human toxicity. Well, the chronic means that you develop an illness or a reaction to something after a long-term exposure to a certain product. Okay, so it takes years before you actually display any kind of illness. Well, this one, when we talk about the signal words, we're talking about the toxicity or danger for the handler, which means that they are the ones that are in contact with, they're exposed to the concentrated product. And so if something were to happen, there could be some reaction within a shorter amount of time, within a few minutes, hours, or a day, and that makes it acute. So the signal words indicate the pesticide's toxicity, specifically for the pesticide handler, okay? So let's take a look at the signal words. We know that we have different signal words, and they are divided into principally 3 categories, okay? So we have category 1, which includes danger poison, and we already saw in a previous example on the label that it had to be written also in Spanish, peligro veneno. And then also in category 1, we have danger. We've included all of the Spanish words just for ease. And then category two, we have warning. And category three is caution. Okay. So what it means is that category one presents the highest potential of toxicity, of acute toxicity for the handlers. Okay. So warning is a moderate toxicity or potential for toxicity, and caution, the lowest potential for toxicity. And again, it does not mean that it is not harmful. So, and the categories are based on LD50s, which means it's a lethal dose required to kill 50% of your test group. So which means that if you have a lower LD50, it means that a smaller amount will be more harmful. And category one, danger poison, it means that it has, there's danger poison and danger, because it's both category one. A very small amount is very toxic. And I'll talk a little bit about what the difference is between the danger poison, why we split these two. If you notice, we put danger poison in this black band. It basically means lights out. It means category one, it's a systemic toxicity, and it has it causes irreversible damage. And in this case, it is death, lights out. Danger and danger peligro is also category one. It's also systemic. It causes, it's more corrosive. So it can cause irreversible eye damage. You won't die, but something will happen. It's corrosive. Okay, so that's why there's a difference here. So again, category three, it is harmful. It doesn't mean that it's not poisonous. Okay, and that's why, again, we read the label. We take precautions for our safety with PPE. We respect the REIs, and we make sure that we're in compliance. If you have any questions, please let us know. I'm going to continue. What else is on the front page? Or first aid sometimes will be on the front page, and sometimes it can be in subsequent pages. So for example, this one here, it's restricted use. That one will have the information on the front page, where you have, for example, on other products that are not danger poison. So the information may be found on subsequent pages, but it's the information presented is presented according to the different routes of exposure. So you'll see on your right, it lists the different routes of exposure. So if it's swallowed, what you can do, what you should do, if it's inhaled, if it gets into your eyes or your skin. Whereas the other one, I believe I can't see it, but it's, hold on. It only has three routes of exposure. Now, why do you need to know that this is on the label? It's on the front page, and because it can have very important information and messages of exactly what needs to occur in case of a pesticide exposure. So it's very important to be familiar with the label, and especially this part of the label. The front page will also contain the contents of the product that you've purchased. So it'll have the weight, the liquid volume, what is in the package. This one, for example, will tell you that it's 2.5 gallons. And you will also find the EPA registration number and the EPA establishment number. And So why is it important to understand the difference between the EPA registration number and the S number? Well, right here you see EPA reg dot NO dot, and then a series of numbers, and sometimes it will include letters. That is the number that is the most important piece of information to track the pesticide in case of an emergency. So if you happen to have an emergency and you're on your way, someone's taking you to the emergency room, and you can only take one thing, that would be the thing to take, because that registration number is linked directly to that one product. We already saw that the manufacturers make different formulations of a product. Each formulation will have its unique EPA registration number, and that is very important. So what about the EPA EST and then a number, letters, numbers? That refers to the EPA establishment number, where it was manufactured or repackaged. And sometimes this could read CA, and someone may think, oh, that's the number that is really important because it refers to California. It just means it was packaged somewhere in California. But if you were to provide that number to someone on the emergency medical people, it's gonna take them longer to find the information. So make sure that you grab the registration number of the product you're using. All right. We also will find the agricultural use requirement box. And this is the worker protection part of the labeling. And it gives instructions on how to protect your field workers and your pesticide handlers. And usually it looks like this, and you'll find it, and it is blocked out, sometimes it's grayed in, and the information that it contains will read something like this: do not enter or allow workers to enter treated areas during the restricted entry interval. So basically it has your REI, right? And should anyone need to enter, it will tell you that PPE required for early entry to this treated area is, and it will list the PPE required for early entry workers. But not anyone can just put on the extra PPE and enter the field. They need to be trained, and they need to be 18 years and older and ensure that they have the proper PPE in order to enter the field. Sometimes you will find information on field posting signs, and it'll say something like notify workers of the application by warning them orally and by posting warning signs at the entrances to treated areas. So it might tell you to post a sign. So how do you know if you need to post, after an application? Well, this is the first place to look. You would come to the label and you would look in the agricultural use requirements, okay? And see what it tells you. But it may not tell you everything, because as we've mentioned before, it's a federal document and California has different requirements, and you just need to know that. So federally, the requirement is if the REI on the label is greater than 48 hours, a field posting sign is required, in addition to whatever the label may say, okay? Well, California has it written into its code of regulation. So here we have a different field posting signs, and these are signs that you can use in the state of California. You may have seen, if you work in another state, or maybe a long time ago, you may have seen a sign where you have an angry rancher, and that is the federal sign. You cannot use that in California, okay? And there are certain instances where in most instances, you can use either one of these. And if you choose to use this one with the blanks in here, make sure that you fill it in with the information that it's asking you. It asks you for pesticide, the grower, and the REI expiration date. Because if you don't and you get inspected, you will probably get a fine. And You can see that the words are in English and Spanish. It has a skull and a crossbone, and again, English and Spanish. When are you required to use this sign? That is when the REI is greater than 7 days, and that is specific to California, okay? So just to recap, how do you know if you have to post? If the ag use requirement box tells you, if the REI is greater than 48 hours, you're required to post. And there's also, if you, and that's in a field situation. If you are applying in a greenhouse, you're required to post at each application in California. Or if you're applying in a hoop house or any partially enclosed area, then if the label says so, or if the REI is greater than 4 hours. Okay. I'm taking a look at the time and I think I have to speed it up a little bit. Alrighty. So what else is on the label? The precautionary statements. Lisa just mentioned that, so it's a perfect segue. It includes three different sections. So there's one, hazards to humans and domestic animals, environmental hazards, and physical or chemical hazards. And why is that important? Well, the precautionary statements tells us, they're important to us because this is where we're going to find information on the signal word, an indication of the toxicity, and also it tells you the routes of exposure to which it's most harmful, okay? And so, for example, on this one, it says, may be fatal if inhaled, do not breathe the spray mist, causes substantial but temporary eye injury, and it goes on and on. And that is really important information to know right before you go to apply it, okay? So, and again, it is outlined per route of exposure. This is also where you're going to find information on PPE. And it is, let me see. So, and this is PPE for the handlers. And let me finish my thought and my statement. If you remember in the ag use requirement box, we found information on PPE use or requirements for early entry workers. Here you have the PPE information, everything that is required for your handlers, your mixers, your loaders, and your applicators, okay? So this is really important information. So I put this little thingy here because I wanted to remind myself to ask you, you can answer in your chat box, California being very special, what is the minimum required PPE in California for an employee making an application? Go. And it's, you know, this is not one of the ones you have to answer, but I just would like to know before I go to my next slide. Yep. So long sleeve, it's long sleeve, shirt, long pants, boots, gloves, and eye protection. And that is where California is different. If you look at the label and it doesn't say you need goggles or gloves for an application, in California you do, and this is where we reference the section, the code section that indicates that in California it is required. So even if it's not on the label, what do you look for when you are choosing protective eyewear? It has to be Z87.1 or Z87 plus compliant, and this is what it can look like. It is clear letters, raised lettering on the side of the goggles or the glasses, okay? And it must have front and side and brow protection, and then you are in compliance, okay? Gloves, we need chemical resistant gloves. Again, if your label does not say you need gloves, if you are applying in California, you need to be wearing chemical resistant gloves. That means if your label says it is waterproof gloves, that's not sufficient in California. So make sure that you have the proper gloves. And some of you may be familiar, I'm hoping all of you are familiar with the DPR, DP, our card. And chemical resistant gloves, these are the materials that are chemical resistant, okay? And all of those need to be 14 mils or thicker, except for laminate and polyethylene, okay? And the only way to know if they're the right thickness is if you purchase it and the manufacturer states on the box the thickness of the glove. Okay, I have to move quickly, otherwise I'm not gonna get through this. And I really do want to get through this for you. So there are more reasons why I want to get through this. Okay, precautionary statements and environmental hazards. It will tell you whether it is toxic to fish or bees, or if you put it in water, it may have some kind of reaction. So this is why you know if it's dangerous for aquatic invertebrates, it'll tell you in the environmental hazards. If it's a threat to water resources as well. The next one is physical or chemical hazards, and that is very specific to understanding that if you mix certain products, you may cause a fire or a deadly gas, and you need to know that before you start mixing and loading and applying a product. Okay, the directions of use. It will give you information very specific about protecting people in the application area, around the application area, and either directly or through drift, but also the rate, the crops or the sites that are registered, and the intervals which it can be applied. So if you apply less of a product, the rate that it indicates here, you are still, it's not illegal. It's also not recommended because it can cause resistance, but you cannot apply it outside of the restrictions here. And you have to make sure that it is used on a site that is registered. So if this were the only site that's registered for this product, you cannot use it on strawberries. You could only use it on whatever the it says in here, okay? I apologize for having to go so fast, but I really wanna make sure we get through this, because if you are gonna take the test, you need to have all the answers. Alrighty, so we're gonna talk about very quickly, the SDSs and the, I think I'm gonna skip this one, and we're gonna go directly to this slide and launch pole 6, unimpeded access. Okay, which of the following documents is required to be displayed at the central location so that workers have unimpeded access to it? Restricted materials permit, an SDS, the safety data sheet, or the pesticide label? And correct, the correct answer is the safety data sheet. Those documents are required to be displayed at a central location and have unimpeded access while people are at work. So what are the differences? What are the differences between an SDS and a label? Well, let's remember, the label is a legal federal document, and it provides information on safety, protection, use, active ingredient. And the SDS will have some of that information, but it also talks about solubility, volatility, what to do in case of a fire. So they might have some overlap, but the one does not replace the other one. If you are applying, you need to have the label. And the SDS will have additional information that may help you, but the label is the document that you want to make sure that you have on hand. So let's go to this one. Where are you required to keep the labels and the SDSs? Okay, according to section 6602, a copy of the registered labeling that allows the manner in which the pesticide is being used shall be available at each use site. That means excuse me, that means if you're going to be mixing and loading, that's a use site where you have it stored, where you're going to need, if you're transporting it. So some people actually put it in a binder and they carry it with them. Maybe in your storage unit, you'll have a permanent location for that, but it has to be available at each use site. Okay. And I wanted to show you the PSISs, the AN8, which is specific to handlers and ag. It says that you have a right to look at pesticide use records, applicable pesticide safety series leaflets, SDSs, for all the pesticides used in the last 2 years where you work, and you have to indicate where the records are kept. So again, it doesn't say specifically labels, but they want access. You have the right as a handler to have access to all pesticide information, pesticide safety information, and the label is part of that information. This is what a central display can look like. Okay, so the information from the pesticide, the application specific information, and the SDSs are required to be displayed. And some of the information from the label may be on there, but the labels are just so complex and can be very long, so they don't have to be displayed like that. So believe it or not.
Hey, Maria, yeah. We have one question that might clarify something. So can we supply the label instead of the SDS at the central display?
Well, like I said, the label could be like that whole entire booklet, and not everybody is going to, I think I'm going to defer this one to you, Liz. I think you can supply the label as long as you have the SDS, because the SDS has to be displayed. Okay.
Correct. The SDS has to be displayed at the central location. So yeah. The central location is really important for field workers, not just handlers, and field workers are not trained to read a label. They are provided unimpeded access to the SDS. The label is really important at the use site, so mixed load site, application site, and certainly you can provide the labels, but not instead of the safety data sheets. Both of those documents have to be kept in an archive for 2 years, and that's usually kept in the office. But at the central display, you must provide unimpeded access to the safety data sheets.
But Samuel, I wanted to address your question about will we be covering PHI. We're not covering PHI, but PHI is, and that's the pre-harvest interval. If you look here, it is also located right in the directions for use, and it tells you how much time you have to allow between the last application and when you go to harvest your crop. I don't know if there is any specific information you want me to address with PHI, but this is where you will find it. Sometimes it's in the ag use requirements. Sometimes it'll tell you look for a specific crop or site in the rest of the label. So this is why it's so important to familiarize yourself with the label so you know where to find that information. I hope I answered your question. If not, please let us know. And this point takes me to my last slide. Remember, the label is a federal document. It's just half of the story. You have to know whether there are additional requirements and regulations in California. You have to know if there are additional requirements and regulations at the county level. So please make sure that you become best friends with your ag commissioner, and they can answer most of all your questions, because they will also cite you if you're not doing it, if you're not in compliance. So I want to thank Lisa and Sarah, who behind the scenes have supported me through this presentation and provided you with numerous resources, including what we've posted up here, You can find more information on training at this website. We have a little booklet on making applications, and that's both in English and Spanish, and our safe and effective use of pesticides. So let us know if you have any questions.